West Bow Press proudly presents the abridged audio dramatization of Germ by Robert Liparulo. The germ, a more advanced form of the Ebola virus, has been genetically engineered to infect only those people whose DNA matches the codes embedded within it. If your DNA is not a match, you simply catch a cold. But if your DNA is a match, within days, your internal organs liquefy and you die a most painful death. There is no cure. If you breathe, it will find you. The release of the virus would usher in a new era of power, one in which countries are left without any form of defense, where one person or millions could be killed with 100% accuracy, yet result in no collateral damage to property or those not targeted. That time isn't coming. It is now. Germ is coming. Pray the assassins get you first. And now, Germ by Robert Liparulo, narrated by Bob Michaels. Facts. Ebola is one of the most lethal viruses known to man. With each outbreak, a higher percentage of people who contract it die. In 1995, an airborne strain of Ebola was discovered. Even 30 years after the first Ebola outbreak, no one knows where it came from or where it resides when it is absent from humans or monkeys. The Guthrie test, also called a PKU test, was developed by Robert Guthrie in 1962. It involves drawing a sample of blood from a newborn's heel and helps diagnose certain genetic diseases, such as phenylketonuria. It is routinely administered to all babies born in industrialized nations. Most Guthrie cards, with these blood spots, are stored in warehouses and never destroyed. The blood on these cards contains DNA that identifies the donors. With the advent of gene splicing, scientists are capable of encoding viruses with human DNA. Theoretically, this gives viruses the ability to find specific DNA, specific people. Chapter 1. Hardly resembling a man anymore, the thing on the bed jerked and thrashed like a nocturnal creature dragged into the light of day. His eyes had filled with blood and rolled back into his head. Blood poured from nostrils, ears, fingernails. Despisorio Vero, clad in a white lab coat, leaned over the body. Around him, patients writhed on their beds. They howled in horror and strained against their bonds. Vero ached for them. The body under him abruptly leaped into an explosive arch. Then it landed heavily and was still. The man's head rotated slowly on its neck. For one nightmarish moment, Vero looked into his eyes. Gone were the insanity of a diseased brain and the madness that accompanies great pain. He saw the man within, a man who fully realized his circumstances. The skin on the patient's face began to split open. As a gurgling scream filled the ward, Vero turned, an order on his lips. But the nurses and assistants had fled. He saw a figure in the doorway at the far end of the room.
"Help me," he called. "Morphine."
The man in the doorway would not help. Carl Litt. He had caused this virus, this death. Of course he would not help. Still, it shocked Vero to see the expression on Litt's face. Only a monster could look as Litt did upon the suffering of the man writhing under Vero. Only a monster could smile so broadly at the sight of all this blood. Chapter 2. 13 months later, for one intense moment, sunlight blazed against the windshield, making it impossible to see the traffic streaming ahead on I-75. Special Agent Goodwin Donnelly kept the accelerator floored. He could only hope he didn't plow into another vehicle. The car crashed down in an explosion of sparks. Its front bumper crumpled the rear quarter panel of a Honda before Donnelly's frantic overcorrection slammed the car against the right-hand guardrail. He saw a clear path in the breakdown lane and straightened the wheel to accelerate past Atlanta's lunchtime congestion. In the rearview mirror, the black Nissan Maxima pursuing them bounded onto the highway. The man beside him, Despisorio Vero, turned to look, blocking Donnelly's view.
"They're gaining."
The Maxima was almost on top of them. A figure armed with a shotgun jutted up from the passenger side window. He veered back into the traffic lane. His pursuers crossed into the middle lane and in a burst of speed edged closer. Instinctively, Donnelly touched the outside of his pants pocket. It was still there, the tracking device. He had not been able to place it in Vero's clothing, but it was turned on. His partner could track them. He drew his pistol from the holster under his arm, bringing it across his body to shoot. Just then, the rear driver's side window shattered into thousands of tiny crystals, along with a thunderous sound of a shotgun blast from the Maxima. "Enough of this!" Donnelly slammed his foot down on the brake for a mere instant. The car jolted, and the Maxima pulled ahead. He cranked the wheel to the left. The sedan's front corner rammed dead into the Maxima's passenger door, directly below the startled face of the shooter hanging halfway out the window. The pursuer's car shot across three lanes and fell back. Just as he was registering the descent distance he'd gained on the Maxima, the bloody-faced shooter re-emerged, a new shotgun in hand. Back at the on-ramp, another car, this one a Taurus, vaulted onto the highway. It fishtailed across three lanes before choosing one and bulleting forward. Inside, Julia Matheson straightened the wheel and pushed the accelerator. The pandemonium coming through the tiny speaker nestled in her ear was maddening. Through intermittent patches of static and dead air came explosions of gunfire and shouted expletives. Goody wore a wireless microphone designed for monitoring conversations from no farther than a mile away, but she saw no signs of him. Once again, she tried reaching him on the police band radio. "Goody, pick up. This is Julia." She thought again of contacting the Atlanta police, Georgia State Patrol, her own agency, anyone. But she trusted Goody's instincts, and he had told her not to call for backup. She slapped a palm down against the wheel. It was not supposed to have gone like this. An hour ago, the assignment had seemed boring. Chapter 3. Goody had called her shortly after 6. She could hear his sons laughing and yelling in the background. "Our mad caller's in town. He showed up at CDC this morning." "Vero?" Julia said, still groggy. "He's here?" For 2 days, the guy had been calling, demanding to speak to the director of the CDC's National Center for Infectious Diseases. He had been rambling about an old virus that was really a new virus and a threat that may or may not be related to bioterrorism. As agents of the NCID's new law enforcement division, Julia Matheson and Goodwin Donnelly had attempted to trace the calls and find out more about the man making them. He showed up at Gate 1 about 5, hysterical about getting in. The guard force was about to detain him when he backed up and took off.
"So we gotta find him?"
"He's meeting us at the Excelsior at 9.
"He's meeting us?"
"Well, me. He thinks I'm Sweeney." Mark Sweeney was the director of NCID.
"You're going in wired?"
"Course," he answered, "and bring the SATD. Mollen wants this guy tagged in case he bolts and there's something to his claims."
"Give me 45 minutes.
"See you in 30.
45, she said,
but he'd already hung up. On the way out, she had listened outside her mother's bedroom, then knocked softly and cracked the door. Mae Matheson was sitting on the edge of the bed, reading the label of a pill bottle.
"You all right?"
She looked up, startled.
"Oh, what are you doing up so early?"
"Case came up. Are you going to be all right?"
May smiled, and Julia felt a familiar dull ache in her chest. Her mother was too young to be like this. 53. Multiple sclerosis made her more like 83.
"I'll be fine. Have a good day, sweetie."
Julia smiled a goodbye and shut the door. At their offices on the CDC compound, she had rigged her equipment and strategized with Goody and Edward Molland, director of domestic operations. By 9:05, she was sitting in her car across from the Marble and Gold Excelsior Hotel, listening.
"No sign of him yet," Goody said from inside the hotel's restaurant.
Julia eyed the laptop computer in the passenger seat. Its monitor displayed a map of the area surrounding the hotel. A glowing red dot marked Goody's location inside the building. A cable ran from the computer to a box the size of a hardback book on the floor. Another cable connected the box to a device that looked like a mobile phone antenna. The box and antenna, along with custom software on the laptop's hard drive, made up a unit called the Satellite Assisted Tracking Device, or SATD. It allowed agents to locate a transmitter the size of a fingernail to within several feet from halfway around the world.
"Here we go," Goody said under his breath.
Another voice, breathy and raw.
"Are you Sweeney?"
"Are you all right? You don't look so good."
The other voice. "Don't worry about it."
"I am worried about it. Let me take you to the hospital. We can talk there." The transmitter conveyed the piercing sound of smashing glass.
"Down! Down!"
It was Goody. A volley of booming explosions followed, shotgun blasts, judging by their deep resonance. Julia simultaneously unbuckled her seatbelt and opened the door. She was just about to yank the earphone out when she heard Goody address her.
"Julia, pull up!"
More gunfire.
Pull up out front. I got Vera. We're coming out.
She started the car, cranked the wheel, and jammed her foot on the accelerator. Her car vaulted across three lanes of downtown traffic toward the hotel's canopied front entrance. Just as Julia's car bounded onto the sidewalk directly in front of the hotel doors, valets and pedestrians leaping aside, she heard Goody.
Can't get there, Julia. Get out of here. We're heading for my car in the parking garage.
She cranked the wheel left to shoot back into the street. The wireless conveyed mostly static now. Then,
Julia! Hear me? I'm on McGill. West. Right on my tail.
He was driving away from her. She made a squealing U-turn.
Listen to me, Goody said.
The reception was clearer now.
I recognize one of the shooters. James something. Almost busted him a few years back. Serpico for DEA at the time, as far as I could figure.
Julia bit her lip. Serpico meant he was a deep undercover agent.
Don't call in backup, Goody continued. Not until we figure out why a Fed's on the hit team.
Julia could hear Vero rambling in the background.
As soon as I lose those guys, we'll meet and decide on a plan, Goody said. But for now, it's just us, okay? Getting on the highway, I-75 North.
That was only minutes ago, 20 at most. Now, barreling down I-75, somewhere behind Goody, only static filled her ear. She plucked out the earphone and glanced at the laptop. The glowing red dot indicated that her partner was about 2 miles ahead. Her foot muscles flexed harder against the accelerator. Chapter 4. The man in the pilot seat of the Cessna CJ-2 was obsessed with serving his clients well. One client had said he'd heard the assassin was the best in his field. The man didn't know about that. He didn't care. He did his job, period. That's not to say he was dispassionate about it. He loved his job, which is what allowed him to do it without comparing his performance to others. He held a glass of club soda in his hand and watched the autopilot gently maneuver the control stick. Another thing he loved was being part of a mysterious and fearful force of nature. The ways people personified death fascinated him. The stereotypic hooded, faceless reaper, or Hemingway's stealthy beast that consumed the ill-fated adventurer in the shadow of Kilimanjaro. Even his name fit the lexicon of death. Atropos. The ancient Greeks depicted fate as three sisters. Clotho, the spinner, spun the thread of life. Lachesis, the dispenser of lots, decided its span and assigned to each person his or her destiny. And Atropos, the inexorable, carried the dreaded shears that cut the thread of life at the proper time. This third sister's role was his. He took a sip from the glass and placed it in a cup holder. Then he rolled sideways out of the pilot seat and stood, staying low to slip out of the cockpit. His 6'4" frame was ill-suited for the plane's 5-foot height. The Cessna's cabin had been converted to accommodate a galley. In the back wall, a door serviced a room with a shower, sink, and commode. For better or worse, this was home, as much as anywhere. He bent lower to peer into a mirror. His thick black hair was cut short. He had blue eyes behind thick framed glasses, a strong, straight nose, square jaw, and, when he smiled, deep dimples that made charming the ladies relatively easy. He picked up the television remote and pushed a button. Two 32-inch plasma screens sprang to life, showing blue screens and the words, "Locking in satellite reception." Then an image appeared, a woman slapping a man. The image changed to a kid eating cereal, and changed again to a black-and-white Western. Then it changed again. The channel-changing buttons had been permanently depressed with a toothpick. It was the way the assassin liked it. Frenetic and active, never still. He felt his synapses picking up speed, trying to catch up with the information cycling past. A beep sounded from the cockpit. He returned to the pilot seat and checked his laptop. His new client had fed updated coordinates into the mapping software he had provided upon retaining Atropos' services. The current trajectory warranted a change in destination airports. He found the new airport coordinates in a GPS unit and punched them into the autopilot. The cockpit brightened as the plane banked toward the sun. Chapter 5. We have a lock on the SATD signal. The man who spoke did not take his eyes off the three flat panel displays arranged before him. One showed a 25-square-mile section of Atlanta, with a thick vein running diagonally through it, identified as I-75. A red dot moved steadily northwest along the highway. An old man in a wheelchair turned.
"Can we seize the signal completely?" the old man asked.
"You mean cut the CDC agent out of the loop so only we have it?"
"Exactly."
"Yes, sir."
"Will anybody be able to intercept it once we take it?"
"No, sir. Nobody."
Will this CDC woman be able to reconnect or disrupt our use of it?
If she tries, the program itself will block her out.
Do it!
The technician typed a command and hit enter. The image flicked once. Done. Wheeling away, the old man said,
Now tell our men to back off.
Julius Taurus rammed into the space between the concrete median and the car ahead. The SATD showed her partner at least 5 miles ahead of her now, the assailants all over him, no doubt. As she watched, the red dot sputtered and blinked out. Then the map switched off, leaving only faint grid lines. She slammed on the brakes and stopped in the center lane of the momentarily empty highway. Her hands flashed to the keyboard. She punched in command after command. Nothing. She snatched the radio mic and keyed the talk button.
Goody, what's happened?
She grabbed the wire connected to the receiver for Goody's body mic and slid her hand up to the earplug. She jammed it into her ear. Static. She ripped it out again. With a last futile look at the computer monitor, she hit the accelerator and plunged ahead, blind. Donnelly was about to take another shot at the Maxima when it swerved out of sight behind him. In the rear view, he saw it fly off the shoulder and down an embankment, kicking up a cloud of dust.
Huh, you beat them, Vero laughed, almost giddy.
Donnelly wasn't so sure, but he set his gun on the seat. It felt like he'd been kicked hard in the side. He touched the pain, and his hand came back drenched in blood. Vero stared. He gripped Donnelly's shoulder.
I should drive.
Donnelly eyed him. I don't think so. Vero himself looked terrible. His lips, cracked and bleeding, quivered constantly. His eyes bulged. Blood was crusted around the opening of his ear. Registering Donnelly's quick assessment, he said,
I'm not as bad as I look. Not yet.
Chapter 6. She'd lost them. Goody and Vero had simply vanished. Julie had long ago passed the place they had been when the SATD malfunctioned. 3 state patrol cruisers, cherry tops blazing, had sailed by in the other direction miles ago. They apparently thought the trouble lay in the stalled and battered traffic behind her. It wouldn't be long before they realized their error and started combing ahead for the culprits. She had to find Goody.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.